Please join me in the call to worship based this morning on Psalm 15. Lord, who may abide in your tent?
Those who walk in the
street and do your strife. O Lord, who may dwell on your holy hill?
Those who seek the truth
from
their heart.
O Lord, who may abide in your tent? O Lord, who may dwell in your holy hill?
Those who do not evil to their friends, or
to their neighbors. O Lord, who may abide in your tent?
Those who
do not evil to their friends. O Lord, who may dwell in your holy hill?
Those who stand by
your
oath, even
at their expense. O Lord, who may dwell in your tent? Those who do these things shall never be moved. Amen. The hymn is number 323, How Great Thou Art. Hymn number 323.
Thank you.
Please join me now in the invocation as we pray together. O God, we want to walk with you. Teach us the steps that we should take to please you. O God, we want to serve you. Give us open hands and willing hearts with which to do so. O God, we want to dwell in your presence. Give us the strength to do what will make that possible. These things we pray in the name of our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Beloved, God responds to our desires as we seek to respond to God's expectations. Thanks be to God.
Please read responsively with me from Micah chapter 6, verses 6 to 8. With what shall I come before the Lord?
How shall I bow myself before the Lord?
Shall I come before the Lord with burnt offerings?
With calves a year old, with thousands of rams, or rivers of oil.
Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression?
The fruit of my body for the sin of my soul.
God has told you, O mortal, what is good.
God has told you what the Lord requires of you.
To do justice, to love kindness, to walk humbly with your God.
With what shall I come before the Lord?
Come with justice, come with kindness, come with humility. Amen. The gospel reading comes from Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 to 12, the Beatitudes. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Amen.
The hymn is number 688, "Show Us How to Stand for Justice." Hymn number 688. Your heart. I don't remember the first time I heard that phrase, but I do know that the first time I heard that phrase, I wasn't completely aware of the full import of its meaning. But as a good Southerner who throughout most of his Southern life would hear that phrase over and over again, I came to understand that it can mean one of three things in most cases. There is the rare occasion that bless your heart is simply somebody's expression of affection for you. But it is more likely that bless your heart is sort of a feigned attempt at pity on your behalf, spoken by a person who's just certain that they're in better circumstances than you are, and that they probably always will be. And maybe even more frequently, I came to learn that that phrase, bless your heart, sort of becomes a license to say whatever you want to after that about the person you're talking to, because after all, it's covered by the blessing. Jesus said in these Beatitudes, blessed are. And while I'm not sure that he was exactly going for any of the meanings that we've come to know that bless your heart can mean, I am sure that for the most part, I think we have misunderstood Jesus' Beatitudes. I think we have misunderstood the blessing that is being offered there. I think that we're probably corrupted by those people who've sought to explain what they thought was an antiquated term, and maybe it's turned us in a way that we just don't really get what these Beatitudes are trying to do. Remember, there was that popular California preacher who used to say that what these were the be happy attitudes. And that the way they should really all begin in our modern parlance is be happy. The problem is that there's not a statement that follows any of them that any of us would really want to be happy about. It's not a really good picture when you look at it. Then there was the interpreter who came along sometime later and in a similar vein said that what the word blessed really means is congratulations. But again, I look at congratulations being that first word and everything that follows it, and I suspect that anybody who would have received these as congratulations would have felt like many of you did when you received that letter oh so long ago. Remember? Congratulations, you have been selected by the United States government to serve your country. It's that sort of thing. So what do these Beatitudes really mean? What is Jesus trying to communicate to us by this thing he starts with the word blessed? Well, I think first and foremost, Jesus is being very clear that those who are blessed, those who receive the blessing of God, receive it as a grant from God. It is not something that we can pursue on our own. I'll save you a lot of the Greek verb lecture, but the truth is the verb tense that's here is a verb tense that suggests that what Jesus is saying is that what you get is a gift. It's not something you can go out and get yourself. Sure, we all feel like we should be blessed by God. We all feel that we deserve God's blessing. We have all probably been told at one point or the other that we should pursue the blessing of God. But Jesus seems to suggest to the contrary, that the blessing of God is something that will be granted to us, but not something that we can pursue. Jesus further suggests that the blessing of God comes to those people who are most in need of blessing, and not those people who are flush with the goodness of life. That is perhaps why that group that follows the word blessed there in each case is not a group that we would want to be a part of. All of those people are people who are struggling with life, All of those people are people who are being oppressed by one thing or the other. All of those people who are being blessed by God are people who are in dire and deep need. And so Jesus suggests that those of us who have this life pretty good, those of us who have received of the abundance of our work and the contribution of others, and who enjoy the good life, are not the people to whom these blessings are offered. We don't need them. Jesus suggests that these blessings are being offered to the people on the margins of our world, to the people who, without the blessing of God, may not survive much longer, to the people who need to be lifted up out of whatever it is in their life that is oppressing them. Jesus suggests that the blessing of God comes not to those of us filled with the goodness of life, but rather to those who are most in need. Jesus goes on to suggest that the blessing of God may be a little different than we think in the sense of what those who are blessed actually receive as well. For Jesus suggests that the blessing will come in the form of God's presence with the person in need. Not so much pennies from heaven or dollars from some place that will make our lives better, but the fact that God will walk with us through whatever it is that we are facing. So let me offer you this way to read the Beatitudes. Here's what I think Jesus is saying. Jesus is saying, God will be with the poor in spirit, and theirs will be the kingdom of heaven. God will be with those who mourn, and they will receive comfort from God and others. God will be with the meek and make sure that the meek inherit the earth. God will be with those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, and God will make certain that they are filled with what they hunger and thirst for. God will be with the merciful, and they will receive mercy. God will be with the pure in heart, and those people will be able to see God. God will be with the peacemakers, and they will be called the children of God. God will be with those who are persecuted on behalf of God's sake, and God will make sure that they receive the kingdom of heaven. God will be with those who are cursed and reviled and who receive all manner of evil done against them on God's account, and God will make sure that they are cared for. You see, it seems that Jesus is not so much offering any sort of tangible thing that we think about as blessing to those in need. Jesus is simply saying, to those who face the difficulties described herein, they can count on the presence of God to be with them every step of the way. That seems to be the blessing to which Jesus points in these Beatitudes. Oh, and it also seems that Jesus may be suggesting that the blessing of God on this group may mean the absence of God from those who are not being blessed. In fact, in the Gospel of Luke, in the companion sermon to Matthew's Sermon on the Mount, which Luke puts on a level place and calls the Sermon on the Plain, I-N, not N-E, but in that particular rendition of Jesus' sermon, Luke follows the blessings with a series of woes. Luke says, "Woe to those of you who are rich. Woe to those of you who live blithely careless lives and have a carefree existence. Woe to those of you who are popular. Woe to those of you who abuse the poor. woe for this and woe for that. But Luke does not have Jesus leave us hanging. Luke says that Jesus offers a way to mitigate those woes that are recorded there, and that is by loving God and loving others, by having compassion, especially on the least among us, by abandoning the criticism that we are so apt to give toward those with whom we disagree, by forgiving even when it's hard to do, and by giving of everything we have received from God and from life in a generous fashion. Luke has Jesus say, if we do those things, we can mitigate the woes that may be ours because we're not in the group of blessing with whom God is walking. May God give us the grace to believe that the blessing of God comes mostly to those who need to receive that blessing. May God give us the strength to be willing to be channels of blessing to those who are in need. And may God give us the courage to make sure that those who need to be blessed by God receive that blessing through the work of our lives in honor of God. Amen. We're going to receive an offering at this time. May God bless the gifts that you've brought to give this day.